We are so glad that you joined us today. God wants to do so much for you and through you, and we want to hear about it. So take a moment to share your story with us at mystory@lbtlima.org. If you would also like to contribute financially to this ministry, you can do so at limabaptisttemple.org. Or you can download our church app available for iPhone and Android users. Thanks again for joining us. We hope you enjoy today's message.
The works of your hands. We will stop and give you praise, for great is thy faithfulness.
We will remember, we will. Your grace, you've been our helper, our liberator, the giver of life with no end.
We will remember.
Valleys,
we will look back at all you have done,
and we will shout,
our God is good, and He is the faithful one.
Sing hallelujah.
The whole song, this is my favorite verse right here.
I still remember the day you saved me, the day I heard you call out my name. You said you loved me, would never leave me,
and I've never been the same.
And give you praise,
for great is thy faithfulness.
Welcome to Revive Ohio.
All right, hey, Kyle Lance Martin with Revive Ohio, Revive OH. And yes, tonight is the kickoff. We are officially at our second community, Auglaize County, kicking off Dayton, Miami County.
Yes, we are in Mercer County, our fifth community. It started off in August in Dark County, and now here we are in the winter, in the snow. I love what God is doing.
Revive Ohio has impacted me personally as a dad.
It's impacted the city and the county in a very positive way.
Revive Ohio fired us up individually and collectively.
I wanted to stand before you tonight arm in arm to just give you a visual picture that we are united in Jesus Christ for the sake of the gospel.
Just continue to go forth with our feet. God, I'm asking that you wake up the church to the truth. May we look at Jerusalem and weep over them. Give us the heart and the eyes to see. God, I'm asking for salvation tonight. Not because of numbers, but because of souls. In Jesus' name.
It's real, it's honest, it's straightforward, it's just loving on people. And there's no hidden agenda, there's no nothing. It's just real, it's raw. And that's what I love about it.
I pray that this is gonna continue after you guys leave and just bring the gospel. And I hope, you know, we're still walking the streets, going door to door and, you know, keep bringing people into Jesus Christ.
Came out here today to share the word of God with the Ancillian football team, and over 20 guys accepted Christ today.
23.
It's awesome what happened out there. Great.
This is not normal.
This is the new normal.
It's gonna keep spreading. Even if people didn't hear, I think they're seeing what other people are doing and they're starting to change themselves, and it's gonna be big.
Hey, all day ministry at McDonald's? Seriously, why would you not want to do that?
We got all day breakfast, but now it's all day ministry, baby.
If we keep going to more schools, I'll do this every day.
Okay. We made 60 sandwiches, 30 McDoubles, 30 McChicken. We're going to be going into the end of their lunches, and we're just going to be handing out free food to everybody and asking if they want some love from Jesus, and sharing the gospel, going through the wristbands and the Bibles with them.
Lord, I want to say thank you for this group. Thank you for FCA, the leadership. And God, I say bless those that are sitting and standing. Specifically the ones that are standing, would you encourage them that today is the day of salvation? Just write your name, because we want you to grow in the Lord. We want you to start studying the Bible, and we're going to have Steve and the leadership start connecting with you guys, okay?
I mean,
the Lord is just showing up in ways that you can't predict. And so it's just like a wild ride, but it's so good.
Shake and bake, baby, Dayton, Ohio. And you know that's right.
September day, were you in the yard with your wife and children, working on some stage in LA? Did you stand there in shock at the sight of that black smoke rising against that blue sky? Did you shout out in anger and fear for your neighbor? Did you just sit down and cry? Did you weep for the children who lost their dear loved ones and pray for the ones who don't know? Did you rejoice for the people who walked from the rubble and sob for the ones left below? Did you burst out with pride for the red, white, and blue and the heroes who died just doing what they do? Did you look up to heaven for some kind of answer? Look at yourself and what really matters. I'm just a singer of simple songs. I'm not a real political man. I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I could tell you the difference in Iraq and Iran. But I know Jesus and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. Faith, hope, and love are some good things He gave us, and the greatest is love. Where were you when the world stopped turning that September day? Teaching a class full of innocent children, or driving down some cold interstate? Did you feel guilty 'cause you're a survivor? In a crowded room, did you feel alone? Did you call up your mother and tell her you loved her, or dust off that Bible at home? Did you open your eyes, hope it never happened? Close your eyes and not go to sleep? Did you notice the sunset the first time in ages, or speak to some stranger on the street? Did you lay down at night and think of tomorrow, go out and buy you a gun? Did you turn off that violent old movie you're watching and turn on I Love Lucy reruns? Did you go to a church and hold hands with strangers, stand in line and give your own blood? Did you just stay home and cling tight to your family? Thank God you had somebody to love. I'm just a singer of simple songs. I'm not a real political man. I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I can tell you the difference in Iraq and Iran. But I know Jesus, and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. Faith, hope, and love are some good things He gave us, and the greatest is love. I'm just a singer of simple songs. I'm not a real political man. I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I can tell you the difference in Iraq and Iran. But I know Jesus, and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. Faith, hope, and love are some good things He gave us, and the greatest is love. And the greatest is love. And the greatest is love. Where were you when the world stopped turning that September day?
Amen. Open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. How many of you remember where you were on that September day? Well, tomorrow is the 16th anniversary of 9/11, the attacks that happened on September, in 2001. 2,996 people were killed. And about 6,000 were wounded. You had the four airplanes where 265 of those perished. Then, of course, you had the 125 at the Pentagon, and there's about 2,606 there at the World Trade Center. Now, I'm not here to talk really about that day, because when I got over the initial shock of all of that, and I remember where I was at one of my former churches, First Baptist Church, Tillman's Corner in Mobile, Alabama. I'll never forget that happening. But after all of this happened, my first thought was this: did they know Jesus? That was it. That was it. You remember that church attendance soared in the first few weeks, in the few months afterwards, and then it just kind of got where it is today. People just kind of got over it. I love that song, "We Will Remember." And so the question this morning to all of us: do you remember the day you got saved? Do you remember the day that Jesus called out your name? People, today we live in a world, we live in perilous times. You understand today that we have earthquakes, we've got wildfires going out of control like never before. We have hurricanes, plural. We have wars, and we have rumors of wars. And I really believe in the last days, which we're living in, that there will be that one other big revival where God's Spirit falls like it never has before. And I believe that time is coming. So in Matthew chapter 7 today, we're going to look at the thing the Bible talks about two gates. Now I'm starting a series today called The Road Less Taken. And today we're going to talk about the back road. And I believe for those of you who know the Lord and are very familiar with Scripture, you understand where I'm going this morning. But road trips are a hallmark of traveling. Whether we are traveling far away or we're just enjoying hometown sights, we are all going somewheres. So in this series, I want to tell us how we should maybe take the back road, how we should avoid the potholes, okay? We need to talk about the road less taken. So listen, today, as we hit the road in our journey of faith. Now, how many of you are horrible with directions? I am what you call directionally impaired. Now, I'm being honest. We would get off of an interstate traveling, and when I would pull into the station to get the gas, I literally would have to point my car in that direction. because I am so ADD, and if I see something shiny, I just kind of get disturbed there for a little bit. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? And so I have gone down, I've hit the interstate, I'll get 25 miles down that way and realize that I'm going north instead of south, and then I've got to come back 25 miles the other way, and I'm not a pleasure to be around, Emma Lori. It's not pretty. I'm so directionally impaired, and I can tell you story after story, but I don't want to bore you with that. I have several of those. But you know, in the closing of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus gives a series of contrasts. He talks about two gates, two trees, and two houses. And today we're going to look at the two gates. One is very narrow, and the other is very broad. One is a very popular gate, and the other is entered by few. As we enter, this is what we'll see. Which one person enters, it makes an eternal difference. Think about it. Whatever gate you choose will make an eternal difference. Some of you have chosen the right gate, okay? But you understand that few find it. So let's look at these two gates and draw three lessons from these two gates. Matthew chapter 7, beginning with verse 13. Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction. And those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life. And those who find it are few. Well, the first thing I want you to see is the division. It is either the many or the few. As Jesus talked about these two gates, he thought of all mankind in one of two groups. You see, we often divide people into groups, don't we? We divide people by ethnicity, nationality, color of their skins, social status, education, all those things. But Jesus didn't do that. We see the division of all mankind in the words many in verse 13 and in the words few, the word few in verse 14. Every person in this place right now that I am speaking to is either in the many or the few. The fact is, all of mankind is in one or the other. It matters not the color of one's skin or their social status. Each person is either in the many or they are in the few. So as we look at this division of all mankind, let's notice the group identified by the word many. Now, the many that Jesus spoke about here are those who have never been saved. The word would imply that the majority in this world are in this class. Now, how many of you have ever looked at what they call the world population clock? If you go right now, you don't have to pull it up on your phone, but you'll see that there are over 7.5 billion people in the world. And it is running as fast as you can see it, okay? And so I couldn't put an exact number down because it's changing as I speak. You understand that, okay? Well, understand, according to the world population clock, the population of the world stands at over 7.5 billion. But a sad and tragic fact is that the majority of this more than 7.5 billion people is unsaved. Do we understand that? The crowd is made up of many kinds of people. It is made up of depraved people. Among this crowd are those who favor the pleasures of sin and follow the paths of sin. Now, I want you to look at Ephesians chapter 2, beginning in verse 2. And this is what it says. And I wanted to use the New Living Translation here. Just listen to this. Paul spoke of those who walk in the flesh. It says, you used to live in sin, just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers in the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. But our very nature, we were subject to God's anger just like everyone else. According to an NBC News report, today, more than $12 billion is spent in the U.S. on adult entertainment. Our society is marked by indulgence, sensuality, and immorality. It is the course of the world in which we live, a course in which fulfilling the desires of the flesh and mind are dominant. So it's made up of depraved people. But this crowd is also made up of decent people. Not everyone in this crowd is sin and pleasure crazy. There are many in this majority that are some good, honest, moral, and decent people. Some of the finest people you would ever meet are in this group. They are hardworking employees, good neighbors, and outstanding citizens. But the crowd is also made up of deceived people. It may surprise some, but many people in this crowd are religious people. I classify them as deceived because although religious, they're not saved. Jesus said in Matthew 7:21, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven. So as we will talk about in a few weeks, one can be religious and not be saved. Do you realize we have a lot of religious people today? A lot of religious people. There are 19 major world religions which are subdivided in a total of 207 large religious groups and many similar ones. There are right now about 34,000 separate Christian groups that have been identified in the world. Now, I don't think I'm being judgmental when I say that many within these religious groups are unsaved. There are the many, which represents the majority of this world, the many who do not know the Lord Jesus as a personal Savior. Now look at this. The majority doesn't rule, the majority runs. The majority doesn't rule, the majority runs. Secondly, there are the few. To speak of those that are saved as few does not mean that there are not many who are saved. One chart that I saw said that 33% of the world's population, 2.5 billion, is Christian. The next closest group is 25%, and that's Islam. And Christianity, of course, is the largest religious group in the world. And of course, this number includes Catholics, Jehovah's Witness, Mormons, and other groups. Now, I personally would not call each of these Christians in the truest sense of the word. We cannot be absolutely certain how many true Christians there are in the world, but no doubt it would number in the millions. Now, let that sink in. Let that sink in. I've said things from this pulpit. Some of you, I know you walk out and you have questions. And Billy Graham said this many, many years ago. And then I find out Leonard Ravenhill said the same thing. That only around 15 or 20% of the people who attend God's house on a Sunday morning really know the Word of God. Who really know God. Who are really saved. That would fit into the few. Understand today, we have people who can quote Scripture. They can come. They can do all the religious things, but they do not have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. When Jesus referred to the few, he was referring to the minority. Only heaven knows, people, how many are truly saved. And no doubt there are millions who have received Christ who live in this world, yet they are the minority of the masses of this world. They are few compared to the many of this world. I am so thankful that I am in this few. What about you? Amen. Amen? So that's the division. Now understand, with Revive Ohio coming up, our concentration about this whole Revive Ohio is the many. The many. Like I've said before, there are cripples at the door. And we need to understand that today. This city, this community, our nation is so lost and so broken. But second is the decision. It is either the easy way or the hard way. There are not only two crowds, but there are also two courses. I said earlier that every person here is either in the many or the few. Every person here, as well as in the world, has chosen either the easy way or the hard way. So let's think about these two ways for a moment. First, in the easy way, we see this way is easy for travel. Therefore, as Jesus said, those who enter by it are many. It is the way of the majority. Or to put it another way, the way of the world. Jesus called this way and its gate easy and wide. Verse 13. Simply, it is open to anyone and anything. There are no restrictions. It's open to the moral, the religious, as well as the atheist. It's open to the moral as well as the immoral. It is open to the defiled as well as the decent. Whoever or whatever is welcome on this way without any requirements or any restrictions. There are no requirements to travel this way. And sadly, the majority of this world are traveling that way. Proverbs 14:12 and Proverbs 16:25 says, there is a way that seems right to man. Whatever may, listen, seem right to one is welcomed on this broad way. You see, because one may feel that, okay, their way is right. One person may feel their way is right. In either case, all are welcome on this right way. It is the way of the world. It is the way of the majority. The other way that Jesus spoke about is totally opposite of this way. Jesus described this gate as being hard and narrow in verse 14. This gate is not without restrictions and requirements. Being hard, it is restrictive. Being narrow, it has requirements. I call it the eternal way because it's God's way of salvation. Listen to this. On the easy way, there are many different ideas and opinions on how to get to heaven. On the easy way, one will tell you that if you do good things for others, you will get to heaven. On the easy way, you are told that if you are religious, you will go to heaven. On the easy way, you are told that if your good outweighs your bad, you will go to heaven. On the easy way, you are told that we are all God's children. Yet on this hard and narrow way, we are told that there is only one way to be saved. Jesus said that the gate that leads to life is narrow. The Greek word is stenos, S-T-E-N-O-S. Listen to this. Which literally means to groan because of being under tremendous pressure. It was a word that was used to represent a constriction. It gives the word stenography, which is writing that is abbreviated or compressed. We call it today shorthand. Because the gate is so narrow, you can only get through it empty-handed. You can't bring anything with you. If you're going to enter into this gate, you've got to leave your pride, you've got to leave your prestige and your position behind. In effect, you got to go through this gate stark naked. Why? Because the gate is Jesus. Now don't miss this. You see, the question is not what is the way to heaven? The question is who is the way to heaven? For Jesus said in John 10:9, I am the door. If you enter by me, you will be saved. See, Jesus doesn't need anything that you can bring, whether it is money or morals, in order to put you on the highway to heaven. On the other hand, he wants everything you got. That is why Jesus goes on to say that not only is the gate narrow, but the way is hard. You realize Christianity is simple, but it's not easy. Christianity is simple, but it's not easy. Now, I'm going to say something right now that is going to sound contradictory, but it's true. You don't have to pay anything for salvation, but salvation will cost you everything that you have. You see, in salvation, we give Jesus all that we are, and he then gives us all that he is. But the beautiful thing is, he gives us far more and far better than we give him. We give him our sin, he gives us salvation. We give him our rags. He gives us riches. We need to understand. We give him our rags and he gives us a robe. We give him our problems. He gives us peace. We give him what? Failure. He gives us forgiveness. We give him our losses. He gives us his love. The reason few people enter this gate is not because the gate is too small, but it is because people are too big. We must decrease so that he can increase. Jesus one time said that in order to enter into the kingdom of God, you must come as a what? A little child. A little child. When you come to God as a sinner, you know what he does? He receives you as a saint. But if you come to God as a saint, he will reject you as a sinner. I know that what I'm saying sounds very narrow. But listen to me. But I say that the gate to eternal life is Jesus, and he is the only gate that leads to heaven. The only gate. That's why you have to come with the faith of a child. Now that does sound very narrow. And the reason why it sounds narrow is because it is. In fact, for those of you who go to Israel, you'll hear this and you'll read things about it, but they talk about in the scripture, you know, where it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone to, you know, to enter and go, you know, to heaven. You understand, and over in Israel, they talk about they have the main gate, and then at nighttime, after they close that gate, there's a smaller gate. And for a camel to go through that, he has to unload everything, basically get down on his knees and crawl through. Now, you just kind of have that picture in your mind. That's why few find it. You see, it's becoming more and more common for the world to accuse Christians of being narrow. Unfortunately, that is not just an accusation, that is a fact. But that doesn't bother me because narrowness can be a great virtue. Let me give you an example. When a pilot is approaching an airfield, you know, you've flown, right? And you come into an airport, you see all of these lights, 360 degrees each way, right? But there is only one way that you can land and land safely. Amen? There's only one way that you can do that. But only one direction, one angle that you approach is the right one. It is the pilot's business to bring that aircraft in the right direction on the right angle. Now here's the decision that faces all of mankind. Will you choose to take the hard way or the easy way? The word enter in verse 13 speaks of a definite and specific action on our part. It is a call to make a decision. Each person must make a decision to go through this gate. Again, the decision is which gate you will go through. You see, our daily life is made up of decisions. We make numerous decisions every day, such as what? What we will wear, what we will eat, etc. There are some decisions that have little bearing on life, whereas there are some decisions that impact our life greatly. Many of the decisions we make are monotonous, but one decision is momentous. The most monumental decision you will ever make is, which way will I take? You know why? Because this decision is eternal. It is the most important decision you'll ever make in your life. So which gate will you enter? Which gate will you take? Here's a question I have for all of you. If I stay on the road I am on right now, where am I going to be when it ends? So you have to make a decision. And lastly, the destination. It is either life or destruction. There are two crowds, there are two choices, and there are two consequences. How you decide determines your eternal destiny. Jesus talked about how the easy way leads to destruction and the narrow way leads to life. So in closing, think about these two destinations. First, there is the broad way that leads to destruction. The broad way that leads to destruction. The word destruction speaks of a loss of that which is ruined. The easy way leads to spiritual ruin, and the ultimate consequence is an eternity without God. Luke chapter 16, you can follow on the screen. The poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. And in Hades, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. You see, that is the destination of all who chose to take the broad road. Jesus said in verse 13, the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. It is the destination of a ruined life. Jesus also talked about the hard and narrow way. In this, we see life. Jesus said in verse 14, that narrow way leads to what? Life. So what kind of life is Jesus talking about? The Bible says in John 3:16 that whosoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. Jesus said in John 10:28, I give them eternal life and they will never perish and no one will snatch them out of my hand. This way may be hard and narrow, but the destination is eternal life. The easy way leads to hell, but the narrow way leads to heaven. One leads to destruction, and the other leads to life. One leads to a ruined life, but the other leads to a redeemed life. Look at this. Following the crowd that seems to be going in the right direction will take you to the wrong place. So let me close this out. Destiny is determined by decision. The reason that is true is because decision determines direction. And direction determines destiny. If you decide to go the broad road, you will wind up in a place that's not good. Destruction. But if you decide to go the narrow road, the back road, you will wind up in a place called life. But the truth is, whether you are in heaven or hell, you will live for all eternity. You don't ever, ever need to forget that. However, hell is a place of eternal torments, but heaven is a place of eternal bliss. And the decision that is before each of us today is which one do we want to spend eternity in? See, to me, there is no choice. When I think of heaven and I think of hell, there's too big of a difference for me even to go down that broad road. Many of you in here today, I know you've accepted the Lord as your Savior, but we still have a group that just don't know the Lord. They don't know the Lord. And I ask this question. I've not asked it here in a long time. But if the Lord was to take you out today, you died, and you stood before God, and he asked you, why should I let you into my heaven? What would you say? Well, Jesus, I went to church. Jesus, I was a faithful tither. Jesus, no. Jesus, I believe that your son, Jesus, God, you sent your son, Jesus, to die on a cross for me. And I believe that. See what I mean? I mean, you understand, we got all these answers we think, but there's only one real answer. There's only one way, people, to heaven. So there's a choice that has to be personally made by each person here. I mean, like, which gate will you enter? Before we go into our invitation, we get ready to do the Lord's Supper here at the end. You need to understand when it comes to the Lord's Supper, we're not to take the Lord's Supper without examining ourselves. The Bible talks very strongly about that in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 26 through 28, 9 and 30. You need to understand that the Lord's Supper is a time of participation, but only those who know the Lord. It's also a time of examination, as I talked about. And some of you today, during this invitation, just need to come and lay it all out on the altar and just examine yourself. And if there's any sin in your life, you need to get rid of it today. But it's also a time of appreciation of what God has done for you. It is a time of proclamation, proclaiming, man, what is going to happen when Jesus is coming back. And it's also a time of anticipation, man, anticipating that time. And we need to understand what the Lord did for us, that His body was broken and bruised and battered, and His blood was spilled out. It was shed for everyone in this place and everybody who's going to be coming in these doors in the next week. We need to understand that. People, this is not one of my so much happy, feel good, tell a bunch of jokes sermon. This is a sermon of life and death. And few find life. And I'm asking you with all of my heart today, can you trust Jesus as your Lord and Savior, as the one and only way if you've never, ever, ever done it before? And for those of you who are Christians and you've just got things going on in your life, whether it's in your relationships with your family, with your spouse, with your children, with your job, you've got health issues or whatever today, before we partake of this Lord's Supper, this invitation is open for everybody. And my prayer is that you'll just be obedient to what the Lord asks you to do today. Let's pray together. Father, today as we prepare for your supper, God, I pray today that we would never, ever, ever forget what was really done at Calvary. Father, we thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on a cruel, cruel cross. The Lord to take all of the sin of this world upon him. Father, my prayer today is that if someone doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, that God, they would have enough courage to come and just tell one of our pastors today that they want to be saved. Father, for others who are just struggling, Lord, in relationships, God, with whatever it may be in their life, that God, they would come today before they take of the supper today, God. Lord, for those who just need to come and just, Lord, just maybe just worship you today during this invitation, Lord, at the altar, I would pray that they would do that. Father, we love you, and I pray that we won't get in any hurry today to leave this place, but God, we would settle everything before we leave. We ask all this in your precious name. Amen. Would you stand? Would you sing and would you come as God instructs you today?
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wreck. His treasure, how great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns His face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to I will not.
People, I just want to say again that the Lord's Supper is so, so important. We never, ever need to forget, ever, ever need to forget what was done at Calvary. Amen? Let's pray together. Father, today, as we partake of your supper, Lord, my prayer is again that, God, we would never, ever, ever forget what you did for us. And Father, what you do every day for us, God, I thank you that, Lord, when you came, Lord, when you took the sin of the world upon your shoulders, God, you did it once and for all. So, Father, today I pray that we would understand about the body, Lord, that was just broken and beaten for us, Father, for the blood that was shed for us. So, Lord, today I pray that you would be with us as we go through this time together of partaking in your supper. In your blessed name, I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Now, as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it, and said, "Take, this is my body, which is broken for you." The same way, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink, all of you, for this is the blood of my covenant, which is poured out for you, for your forgiveness of sins."
Father God, we thank you, Lord, for who you are. God, we thank you for the blood. God, we thank you for the gospel. And Father, we get to actively live that out as we should be every day of our lives. God, I pray that you would have your way tonight. Father, you draw the churches together. You draw the body of Christ together. Father, help us as Lima Baptist Temple to be spearheading that, Father, that we would show up and say that we want to be united. We want to come together for the sake of the gospel. And Lord, use us to make an impact in Allen County and bring revival to our area. And we'll give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
We are so glad that you joined us today. God wants to do so much for you and through you, and we want to hear about it. So take a moment to share your story with us at mystory@lbtlima.org. If you would also like to contribute financially to this ministry, you can do so at limabaptisttemple.org, or you can download our church app available for iPhone and Android users. Thanks again for joining us. We hope you enjoy today's message.